Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We are so pleased to see you here this afternoon for this very amazing concert of music. Dr. Mack Wilberg is music director of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. He is also a composer and arranger of international acclaim. And if you listen with any regularity to the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, you have certainly heard his music performed, because much of the music that he writes, especially these days, is for the Mormon Tabernacle Choir and Orchestra. Many of you who are choristers, I'm sure, have also sung the music of Mack Wilberg, and I know you are going to enjoy all that you hear today. I have been an admirer of the music of Mack Wilberg for many, many years, as both the Sanctuary Choir of Roswell Methodist and the Michael O'Neill Singers will attest, because I do a lot of Mack Wilberg music. And we have always enjoyed, we probably have done about 70, between the two groups, about 70 of his arrangements and compositions over the years. Several years ago, my wife and I went to Salt Lake City, and while we were there, we were able to visit a rehearsal of the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, and Dr. Wilberg very graciously met with us after the rehearsal, and we chatted, and we began an acquaintanceship, which then grew into a friendship. And I have visited Salt Lake City several times and have sat in on rehearsals, and I decided about a year ago, it certainly would be wonderful if we could bring Mack to Roswell, to Atlanta, to conduct my two large adult choirs, the Roswell United Methodist Sanctuary Choir and the Michael O'Neill Singers. As you can see, he gave an affirmative answer to that request. And today, the Sanctuary Choir of RUMC, the Michael O'Neill Singers, are joined by members of the Atlanta Wind Symphony, another fine community musical ensemble in this area, and one which I've had the opportunity to guest conduct on a number of occasions. We are all so pleased to be here, and I must say, it was the music of Mack Wilberg that first drew me to him. But as I got to know him, I realized that he was a man of integrity, a man of compassion, a man of enormous talent, and a man who always puts the music first. You're going to get to know him this afternoon as well as his music. In fact, you will know Mack Wilberg, the man and his music, before the afternoon is over. So without further ado, let us welcome Dr. Mack Wilberg. Thank you.
Good afternoon. What an honor it is to be with you this afternoon, and what a pleasure it has been to be here in Atlanta, and certainly yesterday working with all of these fine musicians that you see before you. And before I go any further, I need to first of all express thanks to the staff of the Michael O'Neill Singers, as well as the Roswell United Methodist Sanctuary Church Choir, and a special thanks to my great friend Michael O'Neill, who, as you heard a little earlier, organized this and has prepared all of these fine musicians in such a way that it's easy for someone like myself to come in and do something like this. And so I express especially a special thank you to Michael. As Michael already, I believe, told you, I became acquainted with Judy and Michael about 3 or 4 years ago when they first came to Salt Lake City, and it's a friendship that has developed over these last couple of years, and I certainly appreciate and cherish it, and look forward to many more years of my association with Michael. I told Michael on the way over here that the speaking part I get nervous about. The music part, I'm not so nervous about that. So please bear with me. It's a little bit daunting, a little bit humbling, and a little bit shocking all at one time to present a program, particularly of your own creations. And again, I'm honored that Michael and the fine musicians today would be willing to do that. I believe that Michael also probably told you, the little that I could hear from backstage, that probably about 80% of what I create, what I write, is for my own purpose. Having been a conductor for over 30 years, and of course a composer and arranger during all of that time, I find that I do most of my writing for the groups that I'm working with at that time, and having the privilege of working with, and I've been blessed to work with some very, very fine ensembles over the years. I taught wonderful students at Brigham Young University in Provo, Utah for 15 years. And the first two pieces that we just sang for you, the first two hymn arrangements, were actually pieces that I wrote for the BYU men's chorus at that time. It was a men's chorus of 200 and about 30 young men. And we had lots of wonderful time together. And as I said, I wrote both of those arrangements for them. And then after that time, rearranged them for mixed voices, as you heard today. We're going to now continue with four American folk hymn arrangements. Sometimes people ask me, well, what is a folk hymn? And it is exactly as the title implies. It is a hymn, but it's based on folk material. And the interesting thing about a folk hymn is that most of our folk hymns come from your part of the country. And in fact, I was in the restaurant with Judy and Michael on Friday evening, and a gentleman came up to introduce himself, and he said, I am, I believe, either the great or great-great-grandson of a particular person who had written a particular folk hymn that I had arranged. We're not doing it tonight, but nonetheless. And the reason why these folk hymns are so important is because they are one of the few examples of our true American music. Because most of our music was adapted and influenced by the European culture. However, these folk hymns are our own. And what usually would happen is a folk hymn may begin as a folk song. And when we say a folk song, of course, is secular. But sometimes those tunes were so beloved and were so popular that a person would take the folk song and that wonderful tune, and they would rewrite it so that it had sacred words to it. And most of this happened, probably most of it early to mid 1880s, and most of it, if not all of it, happened here, probably in your region of the country and north. And so we're going to present four of these folk hymns this afternoon, I should say. The first is Bound for the Promised Land. And I bet this is one you've heard before. If you've seen the movie, when I was a kid, one of the big hits was How the West Was Won. And this folk hymn was part of the soundtrack of that movie. So you might recognize it from that. And I wrote this actually for the Mormon Tabernacle Choir when we did a recording of American music probably about 10 years ago now. Then we will follow this with maybe the most recent piece, at least on this program, that I've written, which is Then We'll Sing Hosanna, a beautiful folk hymn. This was commissioned by a choral ensemble in Rochester, Minnesota. And then we will follow this with the American folk hymn, which also could qualify as an African-American spiritual, depending on which way you look at it. This is Down to the River to Pray, and interestingly enough, I wrote this originally for a middle school chorus not far from my home, probably one of the finest middle school choruses I've ever heard, certainly one of the best in the country. And we have sung it many times since that time with the Mormon Tabernacle Choir and Orchestra at Temple Square. And then we will end this group of American folk hymns with another well-known folk hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Probably of anything that I've written, this is the thing that is probably the most well-known. We now present four American folk hymns.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we're going to go down, if you will, a different path for a few minutes. I'm grateful that Michael decided to, that he would like to do this next set of pieces, because I haven't thought about them for about 20 years. So it's been nice to revisit them. And these are pieces that, were written over 20 years ago. Tres Cantus Laudendi are actually original pieces. I'm grateful that you have a beautiful program that has the text printed in the program, because we're going to be singing these in Latin. However, these are three very well-known psalms. Throughout the centuries, the psalms have been a great inspiration to composers, because they are wonderful, wonderful words, and so many of the texts of the psalms address music, singing, so on and so forth. And two, the first one, O Be Joyful in the Lord, is a very well-known psalm. And then the last one, Psalm 150, which not only talks about singing to the Lord, but also tells us that also instruments, trumpet and timpani, and all sorts of other instruments may be used in singing praise. And you will hear some of that in these pieces. As I said, these are original pieces, and from time to time, someone will ask me, what's the difference between an arrangement and an original piece? And the main, they're very much similar in many, many ways. However, one big difference is when you write an original piece, or let me say, when you write an arrangement, you already have a given tune and text. Then when you write an original piece, you may have the text, but everything else is left up to the composer. And so these are three pieces, three songs of praise, written for brass, percussion, and organ, and were originally commissioned by the Utah Symphony Chorus and Brass. And I have to say that the first two movements were written for them, and I didn't finish the last movement at that time. And so I wrote the last movement about 6 months later, and performed the set in its entirety when I was, again, teaching at Brigham Young University. And again, I'm grateful that we're able to do these pieces today. There's always, when you're young, you always know, and you come back and revisit things, you think, well, I could have done that a little differently. But I must say, I think they hold up pretty well. And so, and they are not easy as well. And the choir and instrumentalists have done a great job in preparing these, and again, making it so much easier. I often laugh about the fact, because I've been in this position many times, a chorus and an orchestra will work very, very hard to prepare a piece, and then the guest conductor comes in and stills all the thunder. And that's what I feel like I'm doing today, because Michael and all of these wonderful musicians have done such a great job of preparing this music, it's very fun to be able to stand in front of them and not only savor but enjoy their great preparation. So we now present for you Tres Cantus Laudendi, three songs of praise.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I don't know about you, but I had a lot of fun doing those after 20 years. So thank you. Thank you to the chorus and brass and percussion and organ for doing that. We now conclude our concert going back to arrangements. The first of which is probably the most famous hymn in the world, Amazing Grace. This was written, once again, for the Mormon Tabernacle Choir in a recording that we did probably about 5 years ago right now that also featured a bagpipe choir, and I'm very grateful that we have a bagpiper with us today. Then we will next do an original piece, O Light of Life. This was with a text by a wonderful colleague and friend of mine, David Warner. And then we will end with, again, one of the great hymn tunes ever written, a Welsh tune set to the words, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. All three of these last three pieces are Christ-centered, and as I said, two of the three are arrangements. Again, it's been a great honor being with you here in Roswell, I'm told, not Roswell, Roswell. And grateful to all of you, and especially to all of these wonderful musicians, and also their director, Michael O'Neill. And so thank you again for being with us.